King reached forward with his hands and lifted a slim black cloth head glove clear off his head. The head glove looked like a black fishnet stocking, but with flat plastic featureless eye and ear cups, and a large molded mouth and nose mask, from which a black plastic pipe ran out and down into a box attached to the frame of his sim rig. Whilst in the simulation, the tube delivered oxygen, water, food, smells, gas, smoke, and, through a system of pressurized pneumatic needles within the mouthpiece, could inflict physical sensation or even damage. The head glove was lightly elasticated and clung to his face neatly. He opened his eyes and rested them on a dark blur ahead of him. Slowly, they focused upon a drab gray ceiling above him. The head glove was claimed by a number of long gray finger-like tubes, which took it whilst maintaining it in the shape of his head. The tubes deflated and retracted upwards, taking the head glove with them. King once again became aware of his real body, the dull ache in his sides, a stabbing pain in his shin, and the overall feeling of fatigue, despite having just finished his mandatory 8-hour sleep. He looked at the small 4-inch color screen beside his sim rig. On the screen, a Caucasian man lay asleep in a comfortable bed with a molded Art Deco teak headboard. The man in the bed had a craggy, handsome face, tanned, mid-30s, short dark hair. People had told him he had a faintly passing resemblance to an old 1940s Hollywood actor who starred in a number of film noir detective movies. King had looked him up and found that a great many records before the year 2040 were blocked, but he had been given access to a number of old movies for research purposes once he'd confirmed that Har Los Angeles 1936 was going to be his primary simulation residence. The movies were Casablanca and The Maltese Falcon. They were digital replicas and a computer-generated pastiche of the originals, which had been lost. Nevertheless, King loved them and had watched them countless times. On each side of the bed stood a simple wooden bedside cabinet. On one of them, a pack of cigarettes opened, a jade Art Deco ashtray overflowing with used cigarettes. Grand Central was the name of the computer system that ran all the sims. It had, so they had been told, collected every photographic and cinematic record available. It had scoured old Hollywood movies, read any available period novels, news articles, and built the best possible replica it could. There were a few anachronisms, and pretty much anything from about 1930 to 1940 could appear in the sim, even though the time period was officially and strictly always 1936. The sim cycled the weather around a typical year and made occasional random variations to keep things interesting. Every few months, it would stage a hill fire or explosion, announce a new building project or the demolition of another. King liked to read the daily newspaper, the Los Angeles Times, to keep note of the set pieces the sim would prepare. Since humans lived and worked alongside fake simulated humans, referred to as simulacras, it was probable that somewhere on the side of that hill, one of the firemen battling the raging hillside fires was an actual real human, working alongside his artificial buddies. Somewhere in a gray apartment, that guy or girl would be in a sim rig of their own, living their dream of being a firefighter in old Los Angeles. Despite the intense realism of the AI simulacrus, King loved meeting real people inside the sims. It was always hard to tell who was real and who was not, but there was one sure-fire way to be certain. A sim could not kill you. Only a human could do that. This was one of the most controversial things EarthGov had implemented. EarthGov ruled that in order to police and govern the HRs effectively, they had to have authentic damage, pain, and even death. They argued that simply banning an avatar or applying a restriction of powers or revocation of access could never be fully enforced, so the only truly effective punishment for crimes conducted inside the simulations would be simulation-induced pain. A small device that was part of the nerve stimulation system installed via a spinal tap had the ability to inflict pain as well as pleasure and every other nerve stimulus. It could disable someone's movements, limbs, or activity proportionally within their avatar. If enough damage was sustained, an electric current to the spinal... Fairbanks wandered back to the Duesenberg, dropped the shovel into the trunk, and drove slowly back down the canyon road towards Roosevelt Highway. Fairbanks switched on the radio and dialed it to a local station playing light classical music. He smiled and wound down the window, inhaling the smells of the night. He noticed the air get cool. The car seemed to pass over a seam on the road. The tires went thunk, thunk. He tried to recall that seam from the way up. He couldn't. The motor on his Duesenberg cut out without warning, and the radio began to crackle and buzz before the music faded out to a repeating static. Click, click. Fairbanks let the car roll onto the edge of the road. He reached to turn off the clicking radio. "Of course, now it makes sense," he said out loud, as if a profound realization had come to him. He climbed out of the car, lit a cigarillo, and leant casually against the door, and looked out towards the calm, moonlit bay, and waited. A red line appeared around Fairbanks's neck, and after a few seconds, the body fell to the ground. It remained motionless, then disappeared. At about 1 a.m, the large service hatch doors opened to a vast sim rig cavern, and a pair of spherical service droids flew out into the darkness. Their headlights turned on, and they moved silently at speed towards a sim rig. The sim rig was sloping gently downwards, but moving at speed. The sim rig slowed, and then took a short 4-foot move to its right. In the sim rig, a figure stood up and leant against the gray, pneumatically formed shape of a car. One of the service droids looped a wire around the neck of the figure in the head glove. A small light blinked red on the droid, and in a microsecond, a circular ring of red light illuminated around the neck of the figure. The wire tightened in an instant and decapitated the head from the body. The gray pneumatic fingers quickly lowered the body to the base of the sim rig. There was no blood as the cut had been cauterized by the ring of light. The head glove hung motionless, suspended by feed pipes and control wires. One of the sentinel droids flew up and cut the head glove from the sim rig and sped back to the large open hatch. The other droid detached the rig from the rails and carried it downwards. In a drab gray apartment, the wall opened and a new empty sim rig slid into the docking plate. "Rebecca, deal with that, will you? Drop something onto the road, from your inventory, something big enough to stop them," said King. Rebecca climbed over the back seat towards the back of the van. Leo followed and unlatched the rear doors and flung them open. Three patrol cars were following in a line. Leo smiled and waved at the driver of the first car. The driver snarled back. Rebecca scrolled through her inventory looking for something suitable. She scrolled down the list, A, B, C, and had got to the D's, dressing table, dormouse, dragon, dinosaur, donkey, when the patrol car bumped the rear of the van. Rebecca's finger pressed dragon. King accelerated away after another rear impact, leaving just enough road space for the golden 200-foot-long fire-breathing dragon to spawn. The moment it arrived, it shot out a 50-foot blast of liquid fire, igniting the patrol cars, two of which exploded instantly. The third pivoted sharply right before leaping off the road onto the beach and into the ocean. The dragon flew off towards the hills and began to set them alight with repeated blasts of fire. "Whoops," said Rebecca. "Whoops," shouted King from the front of the van, looking at the burning wreckage in his rear mirror and the large dragon flying past them at speed on its way towards Los Angeles. "Awesome," said Leo. He held his hand up for a high five. Rebecca reluctantly followed suit and shrugged her shoulders. A centurion reeled the lion back with the chain and mercifully speared the Christian, who promptly disappeared. He'd been zeroed out and would now have to restart with 100 credits in some random spawned location in Disco Town. King stepped up to the gate and ran into the arena. The crowd roared. Leo pulled up his HUD and touched the word LION in his special abilities grid. His body instantly transformed into the large, roaring lion. He ran into the arena without a chain and began to chase King. King ran away and Leo chased him slowly. This went on for a few minutes before the crowd began to boo and hiss and throw in rotten foods. The Emperor was sat in a gilded box surrounded by exotic, beautiful men and women. He looked at his consort and scowled. He was not amused. He pointed towards King and Leo and then called out to the chief centurion and raised both hands in a gesture of confusion. "Maul me or something, quick! The Emperor looks seriously pissed!" shouted King. Leo ran up to King and bumped him with his backside by turning round. King fell to the ground. Leo ran up to him and began to rub his head against his face and lick him. Gobs of saliva dripped from the lion's mouth onto King's face, and the fur brushed into his mouth. King coughed and spat and wiped it away. The Emperor stood up and put his hands on his hips. He was shaking his head. He held his arm out straight before him. The crowd booed. He stuck his thumb out sideways. 5 centurions appeared at the gates, ready to enter the stage. "Your breath stinks, Leo. It's going to make me puke," said King. "Stop moaning and start screaming. You're supposed to be terrified," said Leo. King let out a few pathetic screams as Leo rubbed him with his paw. King started to laugh. "Leo, you're tickling me. Push harder," said King. The crowd was booing louder and louder, then they began to cheer. The Emperor looked around furiously, then dropped his thumb down. The centurions released 2 lions who started running towards them. The 5 centurion archers entered the arena and began fixing arrows into their bows. "We're done for now. Get on my back," said Leo. King looked up and saw the lions running towards them. King jumped on Leo's back and grabbed tightly onto the thick mane.